Well, good morning, Rock Fellowship. It's good to be here with my team. I'm missing all of you guys day in and day out, but you know what? We're coming off of this Easter weekend. We know that we serve a God who holds the entire world in his hands. So right now, we're gonna sing about that big, big God that we serve. And we know this is a familiar one, so we wanted to sing it. Come on, say, oh! Tired of being at home at this point. But what I want you to do is just raise your hands and surrender them to the Lord. Because in spite of everything going on, He is still a way maker and He is still in control. And so we can place our faith in Him. And we can sing with freedom these lyrics to this beautiful, beautiful song. I know you know it. So with your family, with your friends, come on, let's sing it out. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You're working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Come on, let's sing it again. You are here.
You are here.
Worship.
I worship you. I worship you.
Come on, He's here and He's working. Come on.
You are here.
You're working in this place.
Working in this place.
Yes, God, we worship you.
I worship you. I worship you.
Yes, Lord, we worship you.
Because you are way made, miracle work, promise keep. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
It's who you are, yes, you are.
Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Come on, He's here.
You are here.
And what is He doing? He's touching.
Touching every heart.
So we worship.
I worship you. I worship you.
You are here.
You are here.
He's mending every heart.
Healing every heart.
No.
I worship you.
We worship you.
I worship.
So you are here.
You are here.
He's turning lives around.
Turning lives around.
We worship.
I worship you. I worship you. Darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Come on, let's sing it out to Him again. Say, you are Waymaker. Come on.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness.
That be the prayer of your heart. Whisper it out to Him.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Come on, let's sing it again. Even if.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
Come on.
Even when I don't see it, you're working.
Even when it looks like there's
Even
nothing happening
I
in your life,
it,
He said He would never leave
you
nor
never
forsake
stop,
you.
You never stop working. You never stop.
Come on, let's say it again.
Even when I don't see it, you're working.
Rhythm of how we've been able to do our services. And usually when we get to the end of a song, I'll pray out for everybody and we'll just kind of go on our way. But what I wanted to do is a little bit something different today. I wanted to give everybody an opportunity to be able to pray and speak to the Lord and lay down whatever it is that's on your heart that may be burdening you or bothering you or causing you to have fear. Or maybe you just want to lift up a song of praise to him in this moment. Whatever it is that you want to do, I wanted to give you that opportunity. So here it is right now. However you choose to, spend time with the Lord. Big God, as the children sang last week, he has the whole world. You have the whole world in your hands. And there isn't a bird or an ant that goes unnoticed. So right now, we just ask that you would continue to be a waymaker and a miracle worker in this time. And that you would continue to dwell with your people. You said you would never leave nor forsake us. So even though it may look like we're in complete isolation, I know for a fact that you're still alive, you're still moving, you're still working in this place. And so we just ask that you would be with us throughout the rest of this service and that you would continue to speak to your people. Because that is who you are. 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 That is who you
Isn't he a waymaker? He is our God. He is our all in all. And what a privilege it is this Sunday morning during this coronavirus pandemic to still be able to worship our God, to be able to come together virtually and in our homes with our families and loved ones and just lift up the name of Jesus to worship our God. And I'm so grateful to be here with you all this morning. Welcome to the Rock Fellowship, our Sunday service. And I'm glad that you are tuning in. And we are excited about what God is continuing to do in and through us as a church, even during this crazy time in our culture and in our world. And just a few announcements before we dive into our word for today. One is that we have been having an awesome time with our Wednesday night Bible studies. So I'm inviting you, if you haven't joined in, we have a Zoom link that goes out. Now, it goes out to all our members. If you're interested in tuning in, please, on the Connect link on our website here where you're streaming. Also, the link is on the YouTube page as well. Click on there and let us know. We'd love for you to join in, and we have a great time of discussion. There's dialogue, so it's not just me teaching or one of our ministers just teaching in a monologue fashion. We actually do dialogue and have some great conversation. This Wednesday was another great time for people to really pour things out and sharpen one another and encourage one another. So we really are thankful for those midweek gatherings like that, which we call Bible study. So we'll be up and running again this Wednesday at 7:15. So we invite you to join in. Also, we'll be continuing to stream on Sundays until we get more information. I know there's different conversations going on and when things may open up, but we'll just see how the Lord leads in that. You know, there's so much going on in even in our country, even in our local context here in Miami, South Florida. And we're going to be just led by the Lord and how he leads us. But we do look forward to gathering together. And I say that because this past Sunday, I was very ambitious on Sunday morning and after service and for the rest of the day. And I wasn't able to finish it. We weren't able to finish it. So we tried to reach those that we couldn't reach on Monday. But we drove around and visited some of our members. Now, before you get alarmed, we called it drive-by air hugs and prayer. So we didn't walk up and hug anybody. We weren't going in houses. We would just literally just stand out by our vehicles and just talk for 5 to 10 minutes and, you know, do our air hugs and just pray with one another. And man, what a treat it was to just see faces live. And me being an extrovert, I just love gathering with our people. And so that was a great opportunity. And we look forward to doing more things like that where we can just love on each other and spend some time together. Also, announcement is for our children's. We'll continue to use those links. You, as members, we sent you out an email, and there's a link. You go onto the website as well on Rock Kids, and there you'll be able to create your login and be able to get materials for children. We got videos. We got printouts. If you don't want to print it out, you better just look on your smart device and interact with the lessons. But it's still a great opportunity for our children to continue to grow in their faith. And for our youth, there's also the same opportunity. There are materials for our teenagers to be able to use. So we invite our teenagers to join in Sunday mornings as we worship together. Also, our teenagers are invited to join in on Wednesday night Bible study because I think it's a platform that's also healthy there for them. But to go to another level, we do have materials that are online where they have videos and things for our teenagers to be able to continue to grow in their faith and their maturity in Christ. So we are excited about that. Now, you heard me mention a link that's on the page, on the streaming page that says Connect. If you are a first-time watcher, what we call a first-time visitor, it's your first time, please fill that Connect link out. We want to know who you are. If you're not in the Miami, South Florida area, know where you are. Put on there, you know, what city, what state you're in. We can show you some love. We want to connect with you. We want to reach out to you and be a blessing to you, however the Lord wants to use us in that. And there's also sections for prayer requests, praise reports. Please put that on there. We had a few people put in prayer requests, and our team made calls this week and were able to pray with those individuals. And the great reports that came out of that were people were really touched and just really reaffirmed in their faith and had great conversations along with that time of prayer. And that's who we are as the body of Christ. We want to edify one another in the faith. And that same is true if you're not a believer yet, but you have questions, put them on that link. We want to be able to make ourselves available to you to dialogue, to maybe answer some of those questions, or at least point you in a direction where you can find answers to those questions. And that's who we are as followers of Jesus Christ. And we are grateful for the opportunity to be able to serve the Lord in all those kinds of capacities. And so with that said, those are our announcements. More to come out. You'll see either social media on our webpage or any kind of emails or links that we send out. Well, at this time, I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to invite you to get your Bibles ready. So pray with me as we get ready to dive into the Word for today, and we'll open up our Bibles. Father, I'm grateful for this opportunity. I'm grateful to be able to dive into your Word. I pray that during this time of what we call the sermon, where we read the Word of God and we expound on it, we examine it, I pray that your Holy Spirit moves in the midst. I pray that your Spirit flows through, that you capture our attention, that we may understand and receive what you have for us, so that we may respond in the appropriate fashion, which is trusting you at your word. And we will give your name all the glory, honor, and praise. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before we read our passage, there is something that I have to share with you. That is a hard truth, and I want you to brace yourself for it. This is a very hard truth, and I want you to not argue with me. I don't want, there's no debate. Well, I'm not in front of you now anyway, but don't even send anything online. I'm going to say something that's a hard truth. It's a hard pill to swallow, but I want you to swallow it so we can do something about it. And this is this. We are all liars. All right, I know that's tough. Some of us consider ourselves be, you know, honest people, but we are all liars. And what I mean by that is this: all of us are guilty of receiving something on one of our smart devices, on our laptops, on our iPads, tablets, cell phones, anything where we're going to an app or we're entering into an agreement, and there's this link that says click here or sign here if you've read all the terms and agreement. And just about all of us will click yes, and we know good and well we didn't read it. All that fine print, all that long reading, it's like, look, I got the gist of it. I know what I want, and I click yes, I sign it, and we know good and well we did not read it. I know that's convicting, but it's a lie, and I pray that we can get better and grow from that, but we're liars because we don't like fine print. You know, and one thing we don't like about fine print, especially when we feel like we've been gotten over on, like when we've been taken advantage of, and the person that gets us said, well, it's in the fine print. You signed it. It's like, nobody reads that fine print. Nobody's looking at that stuff. We don't like fine print. You know, we see commercials all the time, and it's going fast. And if you look at the bottom, sometimes it says actors, not real people using it, you know. And then there's all this real fast fine print at the end. And it's like, what is this medicine really do? What are they really offering? You know, we're trying to deliberate. Why? Because we got this fine print. And we don't quite know what the agreement is. And sometimes we get excited about the agreement and we don't know what the fine print is. And we're just hoping and trusting that fine print doesn't go against what I actually think I'm actually entering into. I say that about fine print because most of us, while we don't like fine print, Jesus, in his call for us to agree to follow him, for us to trust him, Jesus does the opposite of fine print. He makes the fine print bold and big and seemingly outrageous so that there's no ambiguity of what it means to follow him. I want you to look with me in Luke chapter 14. I'm going to start at verse 25 in Luke chapter 14, and we see in this passage is where Jesus, he has set his sights on going to Jerusalem. He is fixed on fulfilling his mission of his crucifixion in Jerusalem, and he's heading that way from Galilee. So he's starting in Galilee, and he's heading that way, and we see a crowd following him, and he says something here that is seemingly outrageous when it comes to following him. Like I said, Jesus is the anti-fine print. He says, I don't want you to feel like you've been fooled or bamboozled on what this means to follow me. And in verse 25, Jesus, it says this. Now, great crowds were traveling with him. So he turned and said to them, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his own father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. For which of you wanting to build a tower doesn't first sit down and calculate the cost to see if he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, after he has laid the foundation and cannot finish it, all the onlookers will begin to ridicule him, saying, this man started to build and wasn't able to finish. Or what king going to war against another king will not first sit down and decide if he is able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000? If not, while the other is still far off, he sends a delegation and asks for terms of peace. In the same way, therefore, every one of you who does not renounce all his possessions cannot be my disciple. Now, if you don't read that and say that's the opposite of fine print, I don't know what you're looking at, because that does not seem like a very motivational speech to continue to follow Jesus. He's walking and it says that there's a great crowd with him, and he sees all these people and he turns around and says, now, if y'all want to follow me, you got to hate your daddy and your mama, your children and your wife, your brothers and your sisters. Matter of fact, you got to hate your life. Hold on, Jesus. Hold on. That's crazy. And it's all couched in this context of what it means to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. What does it mean to follow Christ? What does it mean to trust Christ? What does it mean when we Christians today say, I've placed faith in Jesus Christ? What does it mean when I say Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior? This call to discipleship is interesting. It's very similar in what we think of today when there's a proposal. You know, a young man is getting excited and he's trying to get over his nerves, and he's gotten a ring, and all accounts and purposes, he's assuming, you know, once I ask, I think I've shown enough that once I ask for this young lady to commit her life to me, to trust me to be her husband and she be my wife, I'm expecting and hoping for a yes. And he proposes, and that proposal is a question that changes everything when it comes to their relationship and how they relate to everybody else. Them entering into that marriage is changing the relationship between parents, between friends, family, the world. This call to discipleship is similar to that, but even at a greater level. So what does it mean to be a disciple? At its basic level, disciple means follower, learner of. You know, it means when someone is a disciple of another, they are following and learning of them to become like that person. So when Jesus says that someone cannot be my disciple, he's saying things of, if you don't line up with these things, you won't be learning and becoming like me. See, he's going against this fine print, and he's saying, I want you to understand what this really means. And then he even heightens the level of what he's saying when he says this. He uses the language in this text of going after me or coming after me. It's language in the Old Testament, in the Old Covenant, when the ways of Yahweh, the ways of Jehovah, the ways of the Lord, in contrast to the pagan gods, to idolatry. And it says that going after false gods rather than going after the Lord, going after Yahweh, Jehovah himself. Instead of saying going after the Lord, he's saying that going after me, coming after me. Jesus is putting himself on a level. He's making a statement about who he is and what it means to commit to following him. And in this commitment to following Jesus, He starts off right off the bat and letting them know that to follow Jesus, to be a disciple of Jesus Christ, is to make Jesus top priority. The top priority. Now, when we talk about top priorities, we really do understand what that means. Sometimes we act like we don't know what priorities are, but we all live our lives completely off what we prioritize over other things. You know, when you have children, one of the things is, would you rather? Would you rather do this or that? Would you rather have this or that? All that's doing is showing where your priorities lie at that moment. Might be different tomorrow, might be different in a week, but at that moment, where do your priorities lie? When I say priority, we're talking about something that influences everything else in your life, something that influences every other decision that you make. You know, some people, they prioritize, you know, they say, like, I'm committed. I am going to church. So everything else throughout my week or that day will follow me going to church. Some people, they have a priority of, you know, I'm going to lose this weight. My health is important to me. So what I eat and how I eat is taking precedent and priority over the rest of my life. So the way I'm buying my food, where I shop, what I put in my body, what I say yes to, what I say no to, all these things follow that priority. You know, I have friends that are loan officers. I used to be a loan officer myself, man. When I stopped playing football, I did mortgages for home loans. And we used to always have to tell people when they were going through the process, before they close on the house, we'd be like, look, we have you in underwriting. Do not go out and buy a car. Do not go open up another credit card, because you will mess around and destroy everything that we've built that's getting you approved for this home loan. One of the most heartbreaking things is to see somebody come in when underwriting is being finalized and they drive up in a brand new, you know, Cadillac. They drive up in a brand new BMW and you're like, oh my gosh, oh my goodness, because now that has wrecked everything. It changes everything on the loan and they will be not approved. But if that house is the priority, they'll say, I'm not getting anything. I'm not going anywhere. Matter of fact, we're going to eat off the dollar menu until we get close on that house. Why? Because the house is the priority. We order our lives by what we prioritize. Jesus says, if you want to come after me, you have to hate your own father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life. And if you don't, you cannot be my disciple. Hold on. Jesus, who's all about love, says, I gotta hate my mom and my daddy. I gotta hate my wife and my kids. I gotta hate my brother and my sisters. Hold on. This doesn't sound like the Jesus I hear about and read about in the other parts of the Bible. I don't know if I like this Jesus. Maybe Jesus didn't say this. Maybe we just take this. How about we just ignore that? Or not my Jesus. My Jesus wouldn't say that. Well, we got to understand, Jesus is seeing this crowd following him and people are all excited. And he turns around and says, I don't want your commitment to be based off an excitement or an emotional decision. Let me let you know what it really means to follow me. And he uses this hyperbole, this language that's used in Semitic language and where Jesus comes from in his context, that's not the emotional, psychological hate that we think of when we read this word, but it's this loveless. But it is a hyperbole of what he's saying, meaning your commitment to Christ is at a level where your allegiances to all those other relationships seem like hate. That's a huge disproportion. It says that I will love and commit to Jesus so much that it seems like I may hate my father and my mother, my wife and my kids, my brother and my sisters. Now, Jesus does not call us to hate people. What he is doing is setting a contrast of what it means to truly be committed to him above all others. And he is to be the top priority. Top priority. He says, you got to hate this. But then he doesn't just say even the relationships. He says one's own life. And in case you don't understand that, Jesus follows up. He doubles down and says, if you are not willing to bear your own cross, you cannot be my disciple. Now, in our culture, it's like bear my cross. Like, what does that mean? Some people use that kind of just in tough times. You know, I'm going through a tough time and I got to bear my own cross. That was very emphatic language in the first century context in which he's teaching in first century Israel, being under the rule of Rome. Non-Roman citizens were punished under capital punishment by crucifixion. Part of crucifixion was that once you were sentenced to crucifixion, to die on a cross, you would carry your own cross out to where you would be nailed and hung on it to die. So when Jesus says, if you're not willing to bear your own cross to follow me, you cannot be my disciple. You know what that's saying? Think about this crowd. You're walking in this crowd and Jesus just turns around and says, hey, if you're not willing to die for me, you can't be my disciple. I was reading and I thought about, you know, my dad used to tell me, I'm growing up way before I was going to be a preacher. I never even imagined I'd be a preacher back then. And I remember him telling me, and he was teaching me about what it means to be a husband. You know, what it means to be, you know, a husband and really love your wife. And he used to tell me when he would do premarital counseling with couples, one of the first questions he would ask the potential groom is, you willing to die for her? And if he couldn't say yes, he was like, we don't need to go any further now. We need to discuss some other things. And I remember being young and I'm like, man, that's a hard question. It's like, man, like, can he be married to her for a little while before he can decide whether he's going to die for her? But what my dad was getting at was in Ephesians 5, where the Apostle Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, writes these commands for husbands to love their wives as Christ loves the church, as Christ laid down his life for the church. So my dad was appealing to scripture on that. And I was like, and it began to make sense what the call was. And it made me think like, you know, a love and a commitment that's so great and so self-sacrificial that I'm willing to lay down my life. Jesus is calling. If you're going to be his disciple, you have to be so lovingly committed and selfless to follow Jesus is that you are willing to lay down your life for Jesus. What that means is even if your life is on the line, you will not compromise your commitment to Christ. Makes me think of a young lady, real famous, named Rachel, back in the Columbine shooting. She was the first one to be shot at the Columbine High School, and they walked up to her, and she was known for her faith. And one of the young men put a gun on her head and said, you still believe in that Jesus? And she looked right at him with a gun on her face and said, yes, and he pulled the trigger. I hope I have that kind of boldness. Sometimes we say what we will do. Like Peter said he won't deny Christ. He denied him three times and Jesus knew it. I hope I can be as bold that I'm not willing to compromise my commitment to Christ, even if it costs my own life. He says a commitment to him to make him a top priority is to place him at a level above all else. That if compromising your faith and your commitment to Christ, coming from a father or a mother, he says, you choose Jesus. If you got a wife or a child that's calling you to compromise your commitment to Christ, you choose Jesus. If you got a brother or a sister that's calling you to compromise your commitment to Christ, you choose Jesus. Now, these things can be easy for many of us who have believing relatives. You know, you got a spouse, you got a husband. You know, if you're a young lady, you got a husband, and he's a believer, and you're a husband, and you got a wife that's a believer. You know, that's comfortable. You got parents that are believers. You got siblings that are believers. I recently had a young lady reach out to me through a teacher who I grew up with, and she was struggling because she was a Hindu young lady, you know, late teenager. And she had committed her life to Christ and receiving a lot of flack and a lot going on in her household from her parents and grandparents. And we were able to send her some resources, some books and some things to really affirm her in her faith and to give her some things to be able to speak about. But that's something that she's having to deal with, that she's having to choose between her commitment to Christ and her relationship within her own household. I couldn't imagine that personally, but that is where the rubber meets the road. That is the reality for many going back to the first century, even to this day. And Jesus says, he is priority. He comes first. He is above all. And if you're not willing to do that, you cannot be his disciple. It's impossible. And the language that's using is continually, like, meaning you say today, and I'm following Christ, but then you compromise because of some other relationship, you know, or even falling into sin. Somebody that you love and cares about you, and they want you to sin against the Lord, and you choose that sin. He's saying, even at that moment, you are no longer following Christ. You have rejected following Christ to follow another voice. He's making the call, choose me. And then he says, he gives examples of what this looks like. He says, I want you to consider the cost. Calculate the cost of what it means. Consider the cost of what it means to have Jesus as top priority, to have Jesus as number one. And we're familiar with this. We're familiar with evaluating prices. You know, recently, every now and then, we'll take our kids out shopping, and, you know, most of y'all know, and those that don't, if you're tuning in for the first time, we have 7 children, and we'll go out, and we'll try to teach them about finances, about money, and so each one of them will get $20, or if they got hooked up by, you know, grandma and poppy, they got $50 on them. We'll go out somewhere, and we say, all right, you have your money. You can choose to spend it as you wish, but this is all you have. Don't come, and every now and then, they'll come, and they'll try to go over, and they say, hey, can you give me some? Can you give me, like, no, that's above your budget. You can't afford it. Now, they learn a lesson about finances because we want them to be responsible adults, right? You know, we want to train them up. But it's interesting when some of the younger ones come and they're so excited about something and we tell them the price and they look at it. And in that moment, they say, yeah, I don't want it that bad. They put it back. They were all excited about it. But once they found out what it actually costs and what they have, they're like, it ain't worth it. Or they come with a 2 or 3 things, and they say, all right, if you get all of that, then you can't have that. If you want that, you can't have those things. And now they got to decide what's worth it. And they got to calculate, and they got to plan out, and they got to see what's worth it. Can they get it? Can they get all of it or just some of it? They got to consider the cost. When Jesus gives these 2 examples about building a building or a tower and this king, he's given 2 examples of where there is calculations made that affect decision. In this building illustration, he says that no one starts a building project without first calculating what it will take to finish it. Because if they do so, they will be open to public ridicule. Ridicule, I like that word. It just means they mocking you. That's a Bible word too. They scorn on you. They making fun of you. He is saying it is foolish to begin a project and not know whether you can complete it. Now, this is just an example that's dealing with calculations. He's not giving a real story about, you know, other circumstances of completing. He's saying that when responsible people set out to build, they calculate all the costs. They have a budget set to know whether they can finish it. If they can't, they make other plans. He says, so it is if you're going to be my disciple. You need to know what it means, what it costs to follow me before you just jump in. Then he kind of ups the stakes, moving from ridicule to actual possible destruction. Meaning, he says, he gives a war illustration. He says a king going out against another king, and he has to consider, he has to calculate, can I win with my 10,000 versus the 20,000? Once it's discovered whether, you know, they got a shot or not, and they see, we might lose this. We need to send out an ambassador for peace while he's still far off. Why? Because if they get too close, we risk destruction. He says, following him is a very serious issue. It is not something to be jumped into lightly. It's not a quick decision. It's not a decision that's based off emotion. It's not a decision that's based off excitement. It's not a decision that's based off of someone else. Jesus is against the fine print. He's laying it all out, and he wants to be very explicit and say, like, look, this is what it costs to follow me. It could cost you every relationship you have. It could cost you all that you own. It could cost you your life. Are you willing to pay it? Meaning, are you willing to put Jesus in a place of priority to where you say He's worth it. It is worth it to follow him. And what I love about even these illustrations, he's letting them know, remember, it's a large crowd following. He's saying that no matter whether you're rich or poor, you're a peasant or you're a king, he's lumping everybody into his illustrations because he's letting them know that he's worth the cost that it takes to follow him. Jesus is putting something in their face that is astonishing. And he summarizes it just in case they miss it. In verse 33, he says, "In the same way, therefore, every one of you who does not renounce all his possessions cannot be my disciple." He says, you may sit there like, do I got to sell off everything? I got to give away everything? What he's saying is this. Jesus takes the place of all you have counted on to take care of you. Think about in your life that all that you have that thinks gives you comfort, that gives you a peace of mind. You know, some of you, your living situation, you know, your job, you know, your health, your money, your savings account, your 401k, you know, your stocks and your bonds, your whatever it is you have. He says that, are you willing to replace all those things with Jesus? Because if you're not willing to do that, you're actually saying is Jesus is not worth it. I would rather keep these things than to have Jesus. Where Jesus is saying, if we're going to be his disciple, if we are going to be a learner, a follower of him to become more like him, we have to place him as our priority and our source, as our everything. That's what it means by count the cost. We got to count the cost. This is not an emotional appeal that Jesus makes. Jesus is not razzling, dazzling people with fantastic words and phrases and ways of thinking. He's, truth be told, is he's running people away from him. The average person hears that and they're like, man, peace out, man. This dude is crazy. I'm not rolling with him. But Jesus is letting them know of what it really means to follow him. You know, we celebrated Easter just last week. We celebrate the resurrection and what it means. You know, its significance that there's victory over sin and death, and eternal life is found in Jesus alone. And by placing our faith in him, we have been rescued from God's righteous judgment that we deserve. And we now are deemed righteous in Jesus Christ and have eternal life to be with God forever and ever and ever. That call, that appeal, and that invitation is exciting. But Jesus doesn't want us to just make an emotional appeal because we're excited. He wants us to know that in this life, what does this mean? It means this hyperbole understanding of, if you're going to be my disciple, you're committed to me at a level that's like hating your dad and your mama, your wife and your kids, your sister and your brother, and your own life. To be my disciple, to follow after me, is to be willing to take up your cross and follow me, is to lay down your life if it comes to it because of your faith in me, Jesus the Christ. It is to renounce all and commit to Christ. I remember growing up and I was taught at an early age about value systems. You know, talked about cost, but just about value systems. And I remember we would talk about how things are priced, you know, based off competitors and, you know, supply and demand, all those type of, constructs and understandings in the system and economics. But my dad, I was fortunate enough to have a dad that taught me a very simple truth. He said, son, things are worth what people are willing to pay for it. And that's always stuck with me because, you know, something might be worth $20, but that one person, they're willing to pay $100. They're willing to pay $200. You know, you just never know. He says, you know, value is worth what someone is willing to pay for it. And once that value is determined, then everything else falls into place. Once you say, you know what, I'm willing to pay this, and I prioritize it over everything else. You may look at it and say, like, I have to have that painting. You know, isn't it amazing how you have people's rookie cards, athletes on a rookie card that's signed. That paper is not worth a few cents. The ink on that card is worth a few cents. And yet people will pay thousands of dollars for it because they deemed it as valuable. They've deemed it as worth $10,000, I'll pay for it. And it's a card with a picture and ink on it. Truth be told, you don't even know if the right person signed it. But it's valued and you're willing to pay for it. See, when Jesus says all this, and we're on the other side of the Christ event. He's lived a sinless life. He has proven his love in the crucifixion and proven his lordship in the resurrection and his care for us in his ascension and sending his Holy Spirit to dwell in us just as God promised in the old covenant would be the new covenant. Isn't it amazing that Jesus says all this? You know what he's saying to all of this? He says, I'm worth it. Like, I'm worth that type of commitment. I am worth you forsaking all else. You know, earlier I mentioned about proposals. One of the things that we as preachers, we use this language in weddings, and we say, forsaking all others as long as you both shall live. It's saying that no one will come in that place, no one will come into that space, that you will stay faithful to that person. Jesus is saying this, I am calling you to renounce and forsake everything else for commitment to me. Don't put anything in my place. Don't put anything as a priority over me. Jesus is calling to be our first priority in everything else in our lives. Follow out of that. And Jesus has shown he is worth that kind of commitment. He is worth that kind of trust. He is worth us placing a value that there is nothing this world has to offer me. There is nothing the world has to offer me that's better than Jesus. There's nothing that a parent, a sibling, a child, a spouse could offer me that replaces or is better than Jesus. So may our commitment be to Jesus, may we be committed to continually follow Jesus and all other relationships fall in line with that commitment. He says, count the cost. When we preachers give an invitation, I don't want you to come to Christ because of an emotional appeal. I want you to think about what this means. It means full commitment. You know, we're not talking about, you know, that kid that's trying to learn how to swim, and they dipping their toe in the pool. And I'm going to go to church for a little while, and I'm going to test this out. Jesus saying, I want you to dive into the deep end and trust that I got you. That's what it means to count the cost. I want you to think about your life. Think about what the world has to offer. And let me share another valuable truth to you. The world cannot deliver on what it promises you. The world cannot come through on all that it has to offer. It's a lie. It's false. But Jesus is saying, I'm worth it. I'm worth you giving up everything else. I'm worth you giving up every other search. Jesus is saying, I am worth of you placing me as the highest priority in your life and ordering your whole life under a commitment to following Jesus. My hope and my prayer for all of us, for those of us who know Christ, that we are empowered and encouraged to continue to follow, to walk, to serve, and to trust him because he's worth it. And if you haven't committed to Christ, I want to tell you right now, he's worth it. There's no greater thing that you will do. Nothing better than saying yes to Jesus. Nothing greater than receiving Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. And remember, I've said this before, while it's a personal decision to commit to Christ, it's not a private one. He wants you to go public. He don't want you to be a secret agent Christian because he wants to use you so that others around you may know his love, his forgiveness, and his joy. May he be our king and our everything. And he, through us, get all the glory, honor, and praise. amen. Come on, I invite you to pray with me right now as we reflect on this word for today. Father, I am grateful for your truth. I am grateful for the call to follow Christ, and I'm grateful for what it means to be committed to Christ, that there's no ambiguity. There's no faking it. Lord, I'm grateful that you've shown that Jesus is worth it, that Jesus is faithful and true, and that we can trust Jesus with our soul, with our everything, because he is life itself. And we will give your name all the glory, honor, and praise. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Come on, right where you are in your house, I want you to give God a hand clap of praise right now. We are so grateful for what an awesome salvation in Christ. What an awesome redemption we have in Christ. And if you're watching and today's the day that you said yes to Christ, like all that I just talked about, all that we just looked at in the scripture, and you're saying, I'm committing my life to Christ. One of the things I've gotten away from years ago, I used to ask people, are you a Christian? Now my lead question is, when did you commit your life to Christ? Because I want to get to the nitty gritty. If today is the day you're saying, I commit my life to Christ, on that streaming page, we have that connect link. Please fill out. Let us know. Let us know where you are, and let us know if you're committing your life to Christ. We want to pray with you, and we want to follow up with you to kind of put you in kind of next steps. It's kind of the what now. You know, you didn't just go up to heaven when you said yes, when you received Christ. What now? We want to connect with you. We want to point you in the right direction. We want to let you know, because that's what the church is for. That's one of the tasks of the church, is building up and equipping and teaching. And that's what we want to do as the Rock Fellowship. So put that information in there, and we will follow up with you and help you get started in this walk with Jesus. Well, one of the things we do before we close out service is that we do continue in worship in our time of giving. And in our time of giving, we do call it worship because it's a time that we actually, worship is kind of that worth-ship, and it's for us to promote, to give, and to support the ministry of the Lord in our local context. So if for our members and those who are really connected with the Rock Fellowship, as you prepare your tithe and your offering and giving, we are so grateful. And you see it on the links on the screen where we have the Rock Fellowship FL/give. We have the Cash App, and we also have the text to give. So whatever works for you. We also have the mailing address. We have a P.O. box if you want to mail in gift, a donation, our offering, and your generosity and your obedience in giving. It is unto the Lord. You are promoting, you are getting behind what God is doing, and we are grateful. And even in this pandemic, and when we come out of this pandemic, we want to be strong, we want to be vibrant, and we want to be able to do the ministry that God has called us to do. And we only give because he is the giver. You know, we only give out of what he gives us. And so we do it out of gratitude and cheerfulness, not begrudgingly, and we appreciate it. If you're a visitor, if this is your first time watching, or you just kind of tune in from time to time, and you have your own church, we don't want to take away from that. But if this ministry has fed you and you want to give, we invite you, please do what you can. You know, we appreciate your generosity. We pray for you because we know the Lord is going to be using you to continue to do what he's doing in this world. And we are grateful to be a part of it. Well, with that said, we're going to be, I'm about to say dismissing, you know, but we're not gathering. You can tell I'm ready to get back together. You know, I like to be with our people. But as we close out and get ready to go offline, I pray for you this week that your commitment to Christ is strengthened. I pray that you really understand and you've counted the cost. You've calculated what it really means to follow him. And I pray that at the end of that calculation, you've determined and you've realized Jesus is worth our everything. Go in peace. God bless you, and I'll see you next Sunday.
The one who wore our sin and shame, now robed in majesty, the radiance of perfect love, now shines for all to see.
Now alive.